Welcome to Analyst Talk with Jason Alder. It's like coffee with an analyst, but there's no actual coffee. Each episode, we interviewed an expert in the field of law enforcement analysis to share their career-defining stories and to get their insights on the world. Please join us on recognizing and learning from these brilliant minds as we define the law enforcement analysis profession one episode at a time.
I hope many aspects of your life are progressing. My name is Jason Alder. Today, my guest is a former police officer, an instructor, and best-selling author. He's a crime analysis expert and a crime mapping expert, but you probably know him as an entrepreneur. He is former president and founder of Bair Analytics, and now he is the CEO of ZooWho, the free mobile app that helps people organize and nurture their personal and professional relationships. I give you a man who never runs out of projects in which he excels. Sean Bair, how are we doing today?
Doing excellent. How are you? A great introduction. Thank you.
Thank you. There's a lot of pressure on that. There's so much to go over. But yes, I'm doing well. So how is life under the COVID quarantine for you?
You know, it's not bad. As a developer, sort of by nature, I'm already sort of a basement dweller who likes to just sort of lock himself into rooms and to code and to crank on things. So, you know, there were times back in the day where I wouldn't come out of my office or my basement for, you know, days on end, having done coding or focusing on something, and it's not much different right now for me. So I'm actually getting a lot of work done. I'm eating too much, but I'm also getting some things accomplished. So it hasn't been too terribly bad.
You sound like a homebody, just like me. I just enjoy staying at home a lot of the time.
I do too.
So normally, for most of my guests thus far, I have a specific segment that I call the analyst badge segment, and that's a segment in which it's story time and the guest tells a story of how they felt that they really earned their analyst badge. I want to do something a little bit different with you because I'm looking for you to tell the story of how Bair Analytics came to be. Given that, okay, in my opinion, it developed the first crime analysis software and has such a big influence over the profession. I wanted to bring you out here today and just discuss what the inspiration behind creating Bair Analytics and just the story, how it got from the beginning all the way to the end.
Okay. Do you want me to just start the chronological clock here?
Yeah, let's take a time machine back to, what, the 90s?
Okay. The 90s is when I wrote it. Let's step back so you understand why I wrote it.
Very good.
So let's go all the way back to birth because we've got time, right? So I was born in an Army hospital in El Paso, Texas. Fast forward, I moved to California, Arizona. And I basically grew up in Arizona. And I went to Arizona State University. And while at Arizona State University, I was a justice studies major with a computer science minor. And that's when I came upon, at an internship fair, Dr. Noah Fritz, who is also a leader in crime analysis, you know, one of the grandfathers of it, who taught me everything I knew about crime analysis back in the day and got my start in it. Step back about a decade though, in 1982, my dad brought home the first IBM PC that was available as a personal computer. And it was not a cheap purchase for a lot of people back in the day. It was mostly business people who bought this computer. And my dad brought it home, it sat in the family room, and he was going to use it for business because that's what he did. And he wanted to learn it. After a couple weeks of frustration, he basically stopped using it. And I approached him, I said, hey, could I use this? This was in about eighth grade for me. And back then, this is when there was only floppy disks. There wasn't hard drives yet or anything like that. And everything was stored on the floppy. So I took it to read the three books that came with it. I think one was DOS, Disk Operating System. The other was Operating Systems, I think. The third, most important one, is BASIC. And that was BASIC 1.0. And that was a language. And a lot of the applications that were on the floppy disks were written in BASIC. And the computer just fascinated me. Up to that point, I was mostly into sports and things like that. But when I got interested in the computer, I knew that was my life's calling. And so I began programming back then in the eighth grade. And a lot of what I did, I mean, there weren't online classes. Obviously, the internet hadn't been created yet. There weren't really even books yet for programming because there really wasn't a lot of languages that the average person would have used. And so I read that book, Basic, from cover to cover, and I taught myself how to program. And fortunately for me, as a freshman in high school, the very first computer course was offered at my high school, and I took that too. And I learned Basic again. I learned Pascal and some other things. And it just has always been, since the eighth grade, programming's been a way for me to find a problem and solve it. And so in my case, it was trying to make my life easier. It was trying to teach myself Spanish, because if I was taking Spanish in high school, I wanted to be able to do it better. And so I would write programs to help me learn Spanish. It would quiz me. It would do those sort of flashcards and stuff. When I would take math classes, I would write programs to help me do better in math. So the computer and programming was always a way for me to make my life easier and sort of more efficient and effective. So again, fast forward now to college, and I was able to convince NOAA to allow me into this internship that had pretty strict standards. I think they needed a 3.5 minimum, and they were looking for people of certain sorts of backgrounds with the classes they'd taken. And to be honest with you, I had to beg my way into this internship. And it was the first crime analysis internship that was offered at the university. And it was through the Tempe Police Department in conjunction with it. And NOAA even taught a 3-credit hour class that went along with it. And so I sort of jokingly say I had to beg my way into this internship. It's no joke. I went to the fair. I saw him. He had his portable computer with him, which was a 30-pound compact computer, and on it he had some mapping software, and I was just blown away by that. I was fascinated by it, and I needed to be able to do this. And I had gone to the internship fair with the intent of getting into the FBI, because that's what I wanted to be, was an FBI agent. So the FBI was boring. They were doing, basically you make copies and you get coffee, and that was not for me. So when I saw that computer there on that internship desk, and Noah behind it talking as excited as he gets, I was hooked. And so I say I had to beg my way into it, because when he said, well, this is sort of a selective internship and you need to have a, 3.5, 3.8, we're only taking 6 students, so on and so forth, I walked away with my tail between my legs. But then he kept coming back to different classes that I was taking at the university and pitching this internship again. So obviously he hadn't filled the 6 positions yet. So I kept approaching him every time he would come to this class. I'd be like, hey, dude, me, I want this internship. You need to let me into this thing. I'm gonna blow this out of the water. He's like, yeah, your grades aren't there, bro. So, skedaddle. And so fortunately for me, it was ASU, so a lot of the students who had applied had to go through polygraph, and a lot of them couldn't pass the polygraph and the background check. So all these great students that were being accepted into the internship program weren't able to actually get into it because they were getting kicked out based on the requirements. So basically, by everybody else sort of failing out of it, I was able to get that last 6 spot, and that was sort of the start of crime analysis for me. And so while doing crime analysis, we were taught how to do it. We were taking the classes that NOAA taught, and we were very fortunate, all 6 of us, in that we were able to shadow the analyst, Jan Nelson, at the time. And she was showing us, all the software and how to do it and what she had to do to perform her duties. And as we were doing that, go back to me in eighth grade, I'm watching what she's doing thinking, well, that's not the most efficient way to do that, or I could build a better mousetrap with that. So we were using Excel, we were using MapInfo, we had SPSS, and we pretty much had any software you can think of back in the day. And I just found that for what they were asking me to do, which was read police reports and try and identify crime trends in them, a series and patterns, I couldn't do it as efficiently as I thought it could be done. And so I began to write, because I know programming languages, I began to write the very early version of ATACK. And we would use it at the department. And we started finding that it was being helpful and more helpful helpful than Excel and more helpful than SPSS. And we started finding more patterns, legitimate patterns. And for those interns that really didn't use it and were more just sort of reading the police reports and playing that mental Mahjong game in their head of, okay, I remember this crime, this MO and this, you know, point of entry, so on and so forth, they weren't doing as good. And so it became to sort of be the standard that we were using to find crime patterns. And so every day while I was doing the internship and then subsequent got hired as an analyst, I would go back home at night and I would write code. I would write code on the weekends and I would write code at night and I would try and improve ATTACK and I would bring it back into the agency. And at this point, it was just an executable file. And it wasn't a commercialized piece of software. It was just a sort of tool I brought with me with floppy disks and then installed it into our systems. And then we would use it and it would get better and better and we would become more efficient. And then people would be like, well, it should have this and you should make it do that. And I would go back home and I would crank those things out and bring it back in the next day. And it just sort of prospered from there. And then so the commercialization of it wasn't by design as a lot of software is developed. It was through evolution. So what happened was because that internship program in Tempe was so prolific and so good, all these interns went on to other departments to be analysts. And of course, what do they want to use when they go to their departments? They want to use what they used at Tempe. So they would say, hey, Sean, can you give me that? Or can you sell that? And eventually the light bulb went off that, hey, you know what? I can make a buck off this thing. Why don't I go ahead and start selling it to these agencies? And so that was the birth of way back in the day in about 1995. Bair software. And the rest is history from there.
It seems like the programming aspect was a big influence for you. And I can just imagine the reaction at this time when an intern is talking about rewriting a software and coming in and just telling people that have probably been doing it for years that they're doing it slowly. So kind of talking to like, what was the initial reaction when you say, well, wait a minute, that's not, you're an intern and you're telling them that that's not the best way to do it.
You're insightful. You're right. There was actually a little bit of a pushback there, but I'll go back and I'll credit Noah again. The analyst at the time was Jan and Noah was the supervisor. And Jan was a competent analyst and she did what she did. Having said that, her job was not tactical crime analysis. It was the internship program's charge to do that. Her job was more strategic and administrative. And she liked that role and she was good at that role. It was the interns who were tasked with going out and, you know, go be crime, you know, fighters and go be crime trend hunters. And when I approached Noah and said, hey, look, there's we could do this a little bit better. He believed in me and he said, you know what? Yeah, let's try that out. Let's go for it. And I'd already sort of proven myself a little bit though, because prior to writing the application, I was writing stuff in SPSS because you can pseudo code in SPSS. And of course you can write macros and VBA in Excel. And I had already demonstrated that I had turned, in fact, from one process we had that took an entire day to do, I turned it into 8 minutes with a macro.
Wow.
So, I mean, there was ways that I had already demonstrated my capabilities with programming. So I don't think it was a huge leap of faith for him to do that. And I mean, it was, yeah, let's try all things. And so, yeah, it wasn't that hard to, truthfully, that hard to convince him.
But then out of college, you go on to be a sworn officer, correct?
So I, through the internship program, I got hired as a full-time analyst at Tempe. Right. So there's nothing better than being an intern because first, it gives you the opportunity to see if this is in fact the career that you want. And then second, to demonstrate to that organization or to other organizations that you have the skills to do that job. And I had both of those things. I found that through doing that internship that in fact, I didn't want to be an FBI agent. I in fact wanted to be a crime analyst. And I also was able to demonstrate to the department my capabilities. And so I became an analyst. And I was an analyst for 5 years for Tempe. Oh. And my partner in crime was Dr. Rachel Boba. And we were the dynamic duo. And we just had a whole bunch of fun at that department. And they gave us such latitude and they had such confidence and belief in us that it was a really good time. And I think both of our lives. And you can look back to see, I guess, both of our accomplishments, how that department has helped to, you know, has helped foster that the confidence, the skill set, and then subsequent the achievements we've had. But yeah, that's then after 5 years of being a crime analyst, I think like a lot of crime analysts, they realize, okay, well, where from here? Where do I go? What do I do? Can I be a supervisor? Okay, yeah, I could be a supervisor, but is there something beyond that? Could I potentially even be an assistant chief or have a higher position or more authority or more influence into the department? And I didn't see that. I could be a supervisor, but Noah was a supervisor and he was going to be there for a while and I wasn't going to displace him. And I left Tempe and I didn't want to move anywhere else. I love that department. So what I thought was, you know, I think I can have a greater contribution toward the fight of crime, toward fighting crime as being a police officer. And so I'll take all those technical skills that I have and I'll take my problem solving, you know, God-given gift that I've got, and I will go get I will go get the police officer certification, become a police officer, and see how I can continue to contribute that way. And so that's when I did that. It's interesting because they kind of were thinking I was crazy. They're like, what do you mean you want to go from being a crime analyst, making what you're making, to becoming a police officer, doing what they do? You're insane. And I actually had to sign a form saying I'm voluntarily demoting myself, or I'm acknowledging the fact this is a voluntary demotion going from a crime analyst to police officer, because I was making less money. I was going to have a lesser sort of rank in the department. And I did that because I knew the greater good was what was at stake.
Interesting. So then talk a little bit now as you move on as a police officer. I mean, are you running? Are you using the tax software in the squad car?
Yeah, actually I was. I had all of my confidential informants in it. I had some other data in it that I was analyzing. In fact, though, you know, you kind of are hitting on an interesting point where I found other opportunities to write more software to help me be a better now police officer. So a lot of what police officers were doing back in the day was using hand logs, you know, handwritten logs to keep track of all of their times. And in Tempe, we had pretty stringent restrictions on how much time needed to be accounted for, down to 15-minute increments. You couldn't have more than a 15-minute gap in your entire 600-minute day. Otherwise, they'd ask, like, what were you doing? And so, you know, that's a hell lot of handwriting. That's a lot of tabulating to be like, all right, I spent 50 minutes on traffic. I spent 100 minutes on report writing. I spent 300 minutes on this. And so I created just a very simple app that sat on the laptop in the car, and you could hit the space bar to start time, space bar to end time. It was called the auto log, and it automated the logging process. And so, you know, I'd find other little ways to improve the efficiency and effectiveness of being a police officer. I sold that to a couple agencies. It wasn't our sort of breadwinner, though.
Very interesting. So then take me through the point where you're leaving the police department and moving on to doing Bair Analytics full time.
So at that time, it was nice to be a police officer because, unlike being a crime analyst where I was Monday through Friday, you know, 9 to 5, you know, you have shift work and police work. And I was able to bid to get weekend shifts. Now, most would not want that, but I actually wanted the Friday through Monday shift, or, you know, like a Wednesday through Saturday shift, whatever gave me the most weekdays available so that I could build the business. That's what I was choosing. So I would work all weekend as a police officer, Monday and Friday as well. And then Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, I would go crazy trying to build the business. Mm-hmm. And that went on for a couple of years. You know, my wife was helping me run it, and we were starting to become a little bit successful and having agencies use it. And I would do support, and she was doing support. And the nice part about it also was that I wasn't working a 9 to 5 as an officer. So there were hours within even Friday and Monday that I had available to service customers and departments. And it was a good time. It was a very busy time, though. And so fast forward, what happened was Dr. Noah Fritz got an opportunity to go teach up at the University of Denver for a federally funded program called CMAP, Crime Mapping Analysis Program. And its charge was to go around the country and teach people, not necessarily crime analysts, but investigators and officers and anybody sort of in law enforcement, public safety, to teach them how to use this sort of newfangled software, mapping software, on how to analyze crime. And so he went up there and he's been doing that. And then he reached back and he's like, look, we need a manager for this program, and we think you might be a good fit for this. And so fortunately for him, he approached me in June. So remember, I'm an officer and I'm in Arizona and it's June. And And he's wanting me to move to Colorado. So I'm like, dude, my wife is never going to go with this or go for this. She's a native Arizonan. All of our families are both here. It's never going to happen. He's like, well, let's just bring you up and we'll show you around and we'll show you what you're going to be doing. And you can decide from there. My wife and I went up there on what we thought was a boondoggle, a free trip to Colorado. And we both fell in love with Colorado. And I fell in love with the idea of, again, for me, it was, how could I have my greatest contribution to public safety? And as an analyst, I felt like I was doing pretty good and I was having a good contribution to the department and to Tempe and maybe helping some neighboring agencies. But as an officer, I felt I really had a strong contribution to public safety. Now I'm, you know, really impacting the community and so forth. And I thought with this position, I would have even a greater opportunity to impact public safety. And I've always sort of fought for the little guy and I've always had a strong sense of justice and difference between right and wrong. I never liked people being victimized. And so that's always been a passion of mine. And so that opportunity afforded me a sort of a national platform where I would now be able to teach others on how, you know, I was able to and others were able to do analysis and catch more bad guys and prevent future crimes from happening and thus victims, you know, reduce the victim count. So I accepted that job and spent about 7 or 8 years at CMAP and it was a good run. It was fun. It was busy, a lot of travel. But it was good to be able to use Esri's product. At first, we had taught both on MapInfo and Esri's ArcView. Now, mind you, this was the year 2000 that I went up there. And if you were to do an analysis of, you know, what are the two prominent mapping softwares, they were pretty equal, and it was more regional based. So MapInfo was a strong player in law enforcement, and in fact, Tempe used it. We didn't use Esri products. Esri was pretty prominent elsewhere too. And so I had to learn it, but I learned it and I really liked it a lot. And so we taught both of those. So I knew both Esri's ArcView and I knew MapInfo and we taught both of those. And we had an increasingly difficult time filling MapInfo classes to the point where toward the end, we couldn't even fill them. Nobody wanted to use it anymore. And all we were doing was teaching Esri software. But yeah, that was a great time. And again, it was good in the sense that I had a lot of autonomy. And at that time, I had hired somebody. So I was up in Colorado and I was able to hire somebody because of the revenue from Bair Now Analytics. And I was able to hire somebody to sort of be me when I was having to teach. So I hired somebody who was doing marketing and answering calls and providing support, you know, doing web pages and trying to reach out to departments to get them to give me a demo. And then I would go home or I would take a day off and I would do a demo to an agency. And it just grew. So we never took venture capital money. I never got a loan from a bank. The growth of the company, Bair Software to Bair Analytics, was all organic. Whatever we made, I put back into the company. I just, every profit that we had from the company went right back into it to allow us to go to another conference maybe 1 year or to, you know, buy another component that I could incorporate into ATACRAIDS to make it that much better. So it was all about that. So my wife and I just owned it on paper, that is 50-50. And we were able to continue to build it. And eventually, as you know, I sold to LexisNexis. It's kind of a big jump between where I just left off to selling to LexisNexis. But nevertheless, there's sort of how that all went.
So I want to tell you a quick story. You had mentioned MapInfo. It's interesting because I had an internship with the Washington Baltimore HIDA where I worked with Joe Ryan and Kevin Armstrong. And yeah. I was learning mapping at the time and learned both MapInfo and the Esri product ArcView. In the office, there was a debate. Certain people liked the MapInfo product. Certain people didn't like the MapInfo product. So there was this office debate. Like the guys that liked MapInfo used to call the Esri ArcView, they used to call it AssView. And then, of course, the guys that were the Esri people that liked the Esri called it CrapInfo. You know, they were going back and forth. So there was this little bit of a banter between the two products, but totally agree with you. It wasn't far off after that. MapInfo went away and now you only see the Esri products.
I know. And that's all as a result of outstanding marketing and having people who use the product, sell the product to law enforcement. Now, MapInfo was still very big in business a lot of people would prefer it in business. But nevertheless, yeah, it's just interesting how it really took off through the years of CMAP. So yeah, that's sort of an interesting little aside of two pieces of software, and one sort of no longer exists. At least I haven't seen it in a long, long time. And another one is almost the de facto mapping software for every law enforcement agency in the world.
So your business takes off, but you get into more than just police departments and law enforcement. The company branched out to have other clientele. Can you talk a little bit about that other clientele you branched into?
Yeah. So, and that's really where we had our sort of inflection point of, okay, now this is getting serious. And that was also the time where I had to decide, okay, I can't keep doing all that I'm doing. And mind you, it was about this time, 2006-ish, that I was not only teaching at the university, the classes that we had, I was co-authoring a book with Dan Helms and Derek Paulson on tactical crime analysis. I was playing hockey 3 times a week at night, so that was hours on end. And I was flying back to DC 1 week a month, and I was also getting my MBA at the same time on the weekends. It was a busy time, to say the least. And one of those things had to give. But nevertheless, during one of our classes, we had a lieutenant colonel come through one of our advanced classes. This was in 2005, 2006, and he was a brilliant man, Erik Hanson, and he was looking for new techniques to try and get a handle on and predict where insurgents were going to emplace their next IED in Iraq. This is a full swing of Iraq, the war, and he was in charge of trying to analyze data and predict where and when insurgents were going to emplace their next bomb. And so he sat through the class and he thought, you know what? I think these techniques may in fact work against insurgent behavior. Of course, he was right. He's a smart guy. And so he asked, can you guys come out and do this? The charge of that program was not to go do defense work. It couldn't do that. That was not that mandate. But through Bair Analytics, we're like, we'd be all day long happy to come out and see if this could be something that we could help with. Dan Helms and I were, Dan's already got a strong military background, speaks Arabic and all that. So, I mean, he was a shoo-in for that function. And of course, you know, I know how to write some software and I'm no analytical slouch on my own. So we went back there as sort of almost a proof of concept, like, will this work? And Dan took a sort of a half leave of absence, and he went back there for 2 weeks a month. And I went back there for 1 week a month. And we both analyzed the data they had. And we were able to find that by properly setting up the data, because they didn't quite have the right data yet, and by doing the techniques that we had done to try and analyze crime data and predict where and when things were going to happen, we were having some success at the Defense Department. And so we got into that effort. And that effort just sort of took off, because once we were demonstrating and accurately predicting where and when a bomb was going to be emplaced, I mean, that's a pretty big thing. So that needed to ramp up quickly. And so we began to hire people to do that, to be analysts back there. They started using our software. They started using Attack Workstation back there to do that. And interestingly enough, other software that you might be aware of, and then other software that were Defense Department specific software that we learned how to use. And we did that. And it was an interesting time. We had to get our clearances naturally. And at that time, the clearance process was a solid 6 months, 18 months for somebody who, you know, needed additional scrutiny. So it was hard to get people to get into that realm, because we were trying to hire crime analyst types to go do that work. And so nevertheless, long story short, we had that, it still is in existence today, that contract to provide services to the Defense Department to try and predict where and when these events are going to happen. I would say that's one of my greatest accomplishments to date. The one that makes me feel like the best, because without getting into too many technicalities, we as a group were credited with removing more than 500,000 pounds of explosives from the battlefield in both Iraq and Afghanistan, as well as 700 killer captures of insurgents. And that was done with, I don't want to say, about a dozen or so folks that we were able to grow the team to. So that work inspired me like no other, because when I would go back there, just the buzz within that that organization that we were a part of, and the brilliant minds that were in there. I mean, the vast majority of them in there had PhDs from Johns Hopkins and MIT and you name it. They were statisticians, they were linguists, they were GIS experts like you've never seen. And all these people had a common goal of eradicating the strategic influence of IEDs on our troops in Iraq and Afghanistan. I was learning so much. And the beauty of that, though, is that so much that I was learning there, as well as hopefully doing my contribution, when I would go back home, I knew the types of techniques that I needed to build, or the tools that I needed to build based off these techniques to help even better fight crime and better fight insurgents. And those went into ATTACK. And so ATTACK improved as a result of our efforts there. And because of all the influence we received and all the smart people we got an opportunity to be around, and different tactics that different groups were using, we were able to incorporate into ATTACK that benefited, in essence, down the road, the crime analysis community. So that was good. We did that. And while we were doing that, we also got some interest from Walmart and Target and Macy's and Walgreens, because they have the exact same problems that police departments have. They have the exact same problems that frankly, the Defense Department has. How can I cull through a whole lot of data and find patterns in it? And once I identify those patterns, can I predict these patterns that I've identified? Those corporate entities began using ATTACK Workstation. And we provide them training and help them get their sort of data set up and all of that. And that was a good thing as well. And then again, just through sort of people learning of successful practices that others are using, we got approached by high net worth families. It's an interesting sort of thing here. So you can imagine there's a lot of rich people in this world, and there are a lot of billionaires, and billionaires have a lot of assets, and they need to be protected, and their children need to be protected. And so when you have that level of wealth, way beyond where I'm at, I'm talking like planes and, houses all over the place and all this kind of stuff. They have teams that not only do personal protection for them, but they do asset protection and analysis. And so we started providing our software and our analysts to them as well. And that's maybe one thing that I want to make a point of. It wasn't enough for us, as we were building Bair Analytics, to just build software. What we realized is that these organizations, whether they're police departments, sheriff's departments, the defense department, private high net worth families, corporations, they also would benefit from having a person to do the work there too. And so we started this analyst for hire. And so I would, and a lot of people don't realize this is what I used to do, but I would go through LinkedIn and I would look at those departments that I knew had great crime analysis units. And not only would I try and hire away their crime analyst, but I would also look for those interns who put on their LinkedIn profile crime analyst intern, and that they were interning at these agencies, because I knew they were being trained right. So I would reach out to them and I would see if they had a job lined up or whatever they had. And I would look to bring them on to Bair Analytics to either be an analyst for hire or to do, be a part of our team that way. So it was also a way to give analysts, I guess, another opportunity outside of a police agency where they can, in fact, have a crime analyst career working for Walmart or working for a high net worth family or having a place at the Defense Department. And it wasn't the most lucrative, because between services and products, from business perspective, products are always going to be your high profit margins. So the analytical services wasn't a high profit margin, but it was the feel good part of the company too, because we were able to provide people employment. They were able to have the experience working for one of those organizations, and that usually gave them a leapfrog into something even better than what we had provided them. So, moving on to be a supervisor at an agency, or going on to the FBI or doing whatever they wanted to do, it was an opportunity to give somebody that experience and that chance. So, and just more crime analysis jobs, really. So yeah, we branched out into all of those areas.
So how much, going back to 2006, when you start expanding, in 2006, what was the market share looking like at that time? Like, how many police departments were using ATTACK? Do you remember?
I don't. It was several hundred, and it was in multiple countries at that point.
Sure.
And it was also the same time we were starting to create attack raids. So attack workstation, I saw the writing on the wall that attack workstation was a desktop tool. You bought it, you installed it, it sat on your desktop, and one or two or five people used it. And what I saw was the influence from other companies, competitors like Motorola, IBM, and others who were, you know, more into the enterprise software and data sharing and, you know, Coplink doing its thing and IBM doing its thing and all that. And I saw that there could be a better mousetrap. And I thought, you know what? We need to not only provide attack workstation to the analyst, but we need something that the department could benefit from, that a commander or a sergeant could look at and see what was going on or his or her beat or his or her, you know, jurisdiction. So that's when we also realized that, you know, maybe even before that, frankly, that the data sharing aspect was just not there. So go back to Tempe. In Tempe, right when the internet started, we put out a Tempe crime analysis unit webpage. We were like first to the market with that page. And I thought it was a great opportunity to share with the public what was going on in Tempe from a crime and calls for service perspective. But I also saw it as a means that we could share data amongst our agency. Tempe had attack, Scottsdale had attack, Mesa had attack, Phoenix had attack. I mean, pretty much everybody had attack workstation around the valley, but we all had disparate RMS systems, so none of us could share data. And it drove me crazy because I knew that, I mean, Tempe was the center of all that. Crime was coming, you know, through and back and forth all day long through Tempe. And I knew that if we had a more complete picture of all the crime around us, we would find even more patterns and clear more cases. And so I tried to get the local agencies to submit their attack files, those ATX files for anybody who had attack, to this common web page. And it happened, and we were doing it for a little while, and we were sharing each other's data. But that was sort of the first sort of effort to try and get each agency to share a common data structure. Because it's easy to share Excel files, but if the Excel files are all in different formats and you each use different naming conventions, well, you're hosed. So our thing was a common lingua franca, a common nomenclature, being able to have all these agencies share that common structure of data so that we could see the data. And so that's when we began to, you know, sort of envision and write attack raids. And that was based off the attack data structure, which we thought worked pretty well for crime. And we were able to have it because there were so many installations of attack workstation. It was not a large leap to go from an attack workstation to now attack raids, because you already had the data in the structure. We needed it. So all they had to do is submit their attack workstation data. We were able to do that and get agencies to start sharing data. And we had hundreds of agencies across the U.S. that were sharing what we thought was the right kind of data. Because back at that point, we were competing against Motorola, and Motorola had crime report. And what the fam? Because the depth of variables that they had, I knew, were not conducive to finding crime patterns. It's not going to happen. You can't do it with 10 variables. And so I wanted us to have point of entry, method of entry, the suspect's characteristics, the weapon type. I wanted vehicle descriptions. I wanted the full narrative if I wanted to be able to search for keywords. And that was not available. And so that was the, we can do it better and we can create something that we think can actually help analysts and investigators find cross-jurisdictional patterns. So that was a big leap, too, in sort of the technological advancements of the company.
I guess overall, as you look back at the company, when did you know that you made it?
I never did. I was always afraid that there was going to be something else that was going to come along. And that was a good thing, because that motivated me. I always, in addition to my sense of justice, I also have an extremely competitive nature. And so I always wanted to win. And so one of the things that when crime reports was coming out, and frankly, they were kind of beating us, because people then had to choose what to spend their money on. Think about it. If you're in an agency and you just got $2,500 to be able to go buy some, you know, crime analysis software, and you got the big dogs from Crime Reports. They weren't Motorola yet. From Crime Reports coming in, we've got hundreds of agencies across the U.S. and people are happy with it. And it's a web-based tool and it provides information to their public. and you can spend it on that, which is a pretty big bang for its buck. Let's be real. So, you know, the citizens can benefit from crime reports. The department as a whole can benefit from it. So I'm going to spend $2,500 on that. I get a big bang for my buck. Or I can spend $2,500 on a TAC workstation that my crime analysis unit can use. We were, you know, it was a formidable opponent at that point. And so one of the sort of interesting inflection points there was the competitive nature of it got me. And I thought, you know, I cannot let crime reports win. And so that's when we created Raids Online. And Raids, so crime reports was selling their stuff for, I think it's on average, $2,500. And I said, I just stopped all development on attack raids and everything else. I said, turn your attention and crank out. We're going to make the best free crime mapping product out there, Raids Online. And we did that and we started releasing it. And it started taking off because now people would say, well, wait a minute. Okay, I could go spend $2,500 on crime reports, but you offer Raids Online, which is actually better. And for $2,500, I could also get your software, this attack workstation. And so we started really putting a dent in crime reports. And so that was a lot of Raids was created as a result of to compete against crime reports and to free up those dollars so that department could in fact spend it on tools that would most benefit them. And so, anyway, that's sort of how that came to be. But yeah, up to the point where I sold the company, I never rested thinking, I'm rocking. We're crushing it. Life is good. Nobody's going to come and dethrone us or recreate what we've done. I was always worried. I was always, trying to make attack even better every single day and making sure that I was discussing analysis with all the different analysts that were using it to see what they liked. You know, for example, Scott Peacock, who's an analyst in Walmart, one day said, hey, it'd be pretty cool if you did this. And like 2 hours later, I was able to give him back what he had asked for. And so it was always important for me to listen to the analysts, hear what they were needing attack to do for them, to do their jobs more efficiently and effectively, and then work my tail off to give them that. And so that's why that, I want to say it's a bloated application. It's not. It's an extremely robust application because it's just been my whole heart and soul got poured into that application. And it's the only application, interestingly enough, from Bair that I wrote. Not a lot of people know that, but I was the sole programmer on Attack Workstation and Attack Raids and Raids Online and all the other tools to a lesser extent were all built by the developers that we hired. But Attack Workstation, that was my child. And I took great pride in making sure that analysts loved it and wanted to benefit from it and caught criminals with it.
Let's take a break. When we come back, I want to talk about selling the company and get your perspective on law enforcement analysis. And we'll also add some personal interest of yours. We'll be right back. This is Analyst Talk with Jason Elder.
Hi, this is Sally Tarabah, here to tell you that nobody needs to know what first car you have, or what's your pet's name, or what street you grew up on. We all see these on Facebook, and we all want to answer them. But keep in mind that there are people who are reading them, and they're going to go on your bank account, and they're going to say, oh, I forgot my password, let me reset it. And the bank's going to ask, what's the first street you lived on? What is your cat's name? And what color car did you own? And the person reading it, they're going to look through your questions, and they're going to answer, and they're going to get access to your bank account. We call that social engineering. The next time you see that survey, that questionnaire, don't.
Hi, this is Carolyn Cassidy, and I'd like to give some information to you. We've all watched shows on TV where someone comes home and there's been a break-in. Their house is disrupted and possibly items have been stolen. Someone gets on the phone and calls 911. Help, please come. I've been robbed. Okay, let's clarify this. You have not been robbed. You have been burgled. A robbery is a person-to-person crime. A burglary is a property crime. If you are not home when someone comes in and takes something from you, you have been burgled. There has not been a robbery. Hashtag, you were burgled, not robbed.
Welcome back. Before the break, I was talking with Sean Bair, and he was talking about the history of Bair Analytics. You had mentioned before the break your competitive spirit, bringing Bair Analytics to its height. But there had to be a moment in which you knew it was time to sell. Can you talk a little bit like what brought you to the conclusion that it's time to sell?
Sure. I don't know if there was any one particular day or something somebody said or some email that I read that freaked me out. Obviously, it was a progression of sort of an increasing feeling of now's the time. Some factors that probably weighed on me or influenced my decision of when to sell were the other software that was becoming available. You know, there was increasing competition. Not that that is anything of worry, but there was also some competition that that wasn't the cleanest of competition. And I won't call anybody out, but I'll just say that there were some applications that were becoming available that were written with federal grants that were supposed to be made available free of charge to the communities that weren't, that then become commercialized. And so that bothered me. One of the things that's sort of like the, you know, the little thorn in the side is as I'm building my business and all of the revenue we generate and all of the profits that we make, they go right back into the company. We're not asking for venture capitalist money. We're not asking for Bank of America, and we surely aren't asking for the government to fund it. What always bothered me is as I'm doing this and, of course, paying taxes and paying at the highest rate, by the way. So it's a lot of money going to the government. The government's choosing to then say, you know what, I'm going to go ahead and give it to this professor or this group over here or this person over here who says they want to build XYZ. And the government hasn't done their due diligence to realize XYZ is already in 300 departments. You don't have to worry about that. And people are loving, you know, the tool that's available. So the government's not aware of what's sort of available. And the person who wants to get funding sometimes isn't aware or doesn't care to be aware. And so they take, in essence, the tax dollars that I'm paying as a result of the efforts of the company and funding my competitors. And so that was a big, like, what's going on here? So I think that had a little bit to do with it, where it's like, this is getting kind of stupid in some areas. The other thing, too, is a realization that I don't think I was the best business person. So, you know, I was extremely competitive, but I also knew that I wasn't always, you know, the smartest. So I didn't want to have an ego to think, well, I can do this, or I can build this to be a $1 billion business, or I can, you know, I'm the guy to run this. I actually was thinking that a proper CEO may be better suited to run Bair Analytics and could take it to the next level. And I was also, throughout sort of the last 5 years of Bair Analytics, I would say 10 years, I'd really embraced the idea of partnerships. At first, I was a little bit apprehensive about them because, you know, anytime you partner with another company, you got to worry about, you know, competing technologies or them borrowing or it going sour or south or something like that. Mm-hmm. But one of the things that I had learned through doing partnerships with some great companies, a lot of which were RMSs, Spillman being, you know, one of my favorites, was that we can get further together than apart. And so by partnering with RMS companies, I was seeing that we were able to expand our reach, be able to get into more departments, and be able to now break down a lot of those technological barriers that sort of existed between the RMS and the analytical software that was being used from it, like Esri having problems getting data out of the system and us having problems getting data out of the system, so on and so forth. And so through the partnerships, I realized, you know what, if I had the right partner, the software that Bair Analytics has created could just be that much better. And thus, the analysts could benefit that much more from it. So I started looking around, and I had met with, I don't say it's not public knowledge, but it's sort of the first time I've mentioned this to really a group. But I had talks with IBM. I had talks with Motorola, had talks with Integraph, had talks with Spillman. I had talks with a lot of agencies, or corporations, I should say, about, you know, what if I were to sell to you and yeah, maybe we're partnering, but what if you just acquired us? And at various times I would evaluate what they would say, and I would do it with the focus of, is this what's best? Not for me, not for my family, not for necessarily even the employees. Is this what's best for crime analysis and justice? Because again, that's the sort of core of me is justice and fighting against crime and catching bad guys and protecting people. And so a lot of those weren't good fits. Maybe lucratively or financially, they would have been more lucrative than another, but they wouldn't have been a good fit. And I was concerned that, are the employees going to be okay? Because at that point, we were 50 employees in 13 different states. We had the Defense Department contract, and you know, it was humming right along. Everybody seemed to be pretty happy. And why upset the apple cart, right? Because we've got good partnerships and this, that, and the other. So I needed the right partner if I was in fact going to sell. And the best one came along, frankly. I was at a luncheon and I just happened, somebody had mentioned or I happened to drop that, yeah, you know, I'd be open to acquisition if the right offer came along. And that mention in a luncheon back in DC is what started the process of, and it was a year-long process. Not a lot of people realize the effort that goes into buying even a small company like Bair Analytics, but it was a year-long process to vet whether or not this would have been a right fit for that company, LexisNexis. And so they had some amazing ideas about where they wanted to go with their technology. And interestingly, when I had mentioned that to them, we were trying to partner with LexisNexis. Mark Lindsay and I, Mark Lindsay was my business development guy, we were back there quite often trying to convince LexisNexis to partner with us because we knew, again, that what our solution needed was better data. And I wanted to be able to enhance and augment the data that was in ATACRAIDS with the data that I knew LexisNexis had because I wanted the crime analyst or the department as a whole to be able to have even richer, deeper data. And have it sort of cleaned up and stuff because LexisNexis has got the most amazing data you've ever seen in your life. And so what started off as us basically trying to beg them to be a partner ended up being them saying, well, why don't we go ahead and have a conversation with you about just buying you and acquiring you? And so there were, you know, the CEO of LexisNexis, Woody Talkov, and a couple other big dogs flew out and met with Dana and I and had nice conversations and asked me where I wanted to see the company go and where I wanted to take it and what I had in mind for the software. And they expressed what their interests were as well. And the two just aligned magically. And we talked about this other application that we would build that would sort of be the next generation tool. And so they started that process.
You know, you had mentioned that you were the sole programmer for the workstation uh-huh. platform. And so that's kind of your baby. Like, yeah. Tell us what it was like to sell the company. Is it like when you sell a house or is it different?
Oh, it's vastly different. Mm-hmm. Having been in real estate after I got out of crime analysis, I can tell you they're two complete opposite ends of the spectrum.
Okay.
Selling a company is interesting. And so what was even more interesting about selling Bair Analytics, not that it was special, just that it's interesting from a business perspective, is that again, we had the defense contract. So a very large portion of our profits or revenue, I should say, came from the defense contract. And the defense contract, that took us years to get, because the Defense Department just doesn't hand contracts to companies. You have to first be usually a subcontractor to the big dogs. And we were subcontracting to L3 and we subcontracted to BAE, Booz Allen Hamilton. You need to get the idea there. You subcontract to the guys who kind of already have the big contracts. But then eventually we were able to convince the Defense Department, look, we're the only game in town who does this. You know, yeah, SAIC is trying to come in to claim that they can provide crime analysis support and you know, have the right software, but they can't. And so the Defense Department said, you know what, you're right. You are the sole providers of this. We're going to provide you or give you, grant you a DOD prime contract. So put that in context of everybody else who's got prime contracts. Most prime contracts are held by Booz Allen Hamilton, SAIC, Lockheed Martin, Northrop Grumman. And here we were, little Bair Analytics. We had our prime contract too, providing crime analysis services to the Defense Department. And they didn't call it crime analysis services. I mean, it was analytical services. But nevertheless, that's what we did with Attack Workstation and some other stuff that we had created. And so having that, you have to, when you get bought by a company, the company who's going to buy you has to be able to meet all the criteria. So LexisNexis is a multi-million dollar company here in the U.S., but they're owned by a multi-billion dollar company in the U.K., read Elsevier or RELX. So people don't necessarily care, but for what it's worth, LexisNexis is owned by a British company. And so de facto, our company was going to be owned by a British company, you know, through paper, that is. And so in order for a British company, our allies, to own a U.S. company, some of your listeners may have heard the term CFIUS. CFIUS is a vetting that needs to happen that says that when a corporation overseas, not U.S., is going to own a U.S. company that has particular expertise providing to the Defense Department, it has to go through this process. So that took an extra couple months. The entire process from start to finish, and I forget the exact day, I should know this because it's kind of a, you know, like a birthday almost, but it was in 2014 that I began the due diligence process. And in 2015, almost a year later to the date, is when it was, okay, we now own it. The stock is transferred. The money is transferred. You now belong to us and all of your assets and employees and everything else. This is now ours. So I don't think people really realize sometimes in who haven't gone through this or just who haven't sort of studied up on this, that a company, even as small as ours, 50 people, 6 million annual revenue, you know, we had about 13 countries, I think we had. We had multiple installations all over the place. But nevertheless, it took almost a year to buy us. There's a lot of lawyers that are involved. LexisNexis wanted to make sure their T's were crossed and their I's were dotted, and they're wise to do so because you want to make sure you understand what you're buying and all the promises being made by the company that you're buying are accurate and true. And they spent about 8 or 9 months doing that process of the due diligence, another couple months doing the CFIUS, and then just, you know, finalizing things. It was the hardest year of my life. That was the exact same time in 2013, 2014, that I was also trying to get my PhD at the Colorado School of Mines. So because I was looking for new techniques to incorporate into our software, I had gone back to school again. Mind you, I got my MBA from the University of Denver because I wanted to get more skills and how to be a better business person. But I also wanted to get more skills in statistics and analysis to be a better analyst, but also be able to write those techniques and features into attack and attack raids. So I was trying to get my PhD in statistics. It's a brick and mortar school still, Colorado School of Mines. It's a good school, but you don't do online, and it's a pretty, you know, it's a pretty serious school. So for me to take off during the week while doing due diligence, while trying to run still Bair Analytics, while still trying to manage the Defense Department contract and do all that, and go 3 days a week to Colorado School of Mines, which was 30 minutes away, it became too much, and I had to quit mines because obviously there were bigger things that I was responsible for. But that was a pretty busy time of my life, and it was stressful too because the last thing you want are these employees that you love. I mean, I loved our employees, and I wanted to do right by them, and I wanted to make sure they were going to be safe, and I wanted to make sure they were going to be successful, and I wanted to make sure they were going to not be impacted financially in any way. You mentioned ATTACK being my baby. That's not what was the emotional tie. It was the employees to me that were the emotional tie. I wanted to make sure that after the ink was dry, and yes, the Bair family might be okay, more importantly, are the employees going to be okay? Are they going to flourish in this new environment? And so far, it does appear that they are. A lot of them have been promoted and they're doing great, but that was the hardest part of the sales process. And early on in the due diligence, not letting on that I was being bought. That was extremely hard. There was a handful of people that were sort of allowed into that inner circle that were key players or key personnel that had substantial information about the company that also needed to be a part of this due diligence. Erik Nelson, because he did the Defense Department, Susan Hammond, because Susan Smith, as you may know her, because she had, you know, institutional knowledge, and some others who were a part of that initial group because they managed or they had contract dealing, so they knew about it. But I didn't want to freak out the other people. So that was also very difficult early on, is to see if this was even going to work. Were we really going to get bought? And so that was a year of worry of whether or not this was even going to be the right fit, too.
I have to ask, And I know you have a nice polished answer for this. What was the sales price of Bair Analytics?
Yeah, I'm under NDA and non-disclosure not to discuss that. Obviously, it's a private company buying a private company, so they don't say that. And they've expressly asked me not to say that. People can do math and people can speculate. Most people are probably wrong when they guess how much it was sold for. I'll just say that we were at $6 million revenue, and sometimes companies get multiples of their revenue. Sometimes they get multiples of their EBITDA, the earnings before taxes, depreciation, and amortization. We were a little over $1 million in EBITDA each year, which is pretty good. So we got a very fair price for our company. I'll say that. I think they got a good deal, and I think we got a good deal. I think it was a win-win. There wasn't any sort of like, they hosed me, or I stuck it to them. They, you know, look what they just bought. I think it was a good fit too. Now, mind you, they were not the highest price. I mentioned I talked with other people. I will say they weren't the highest, because other people at that last moment, when they knew we were going through due diligence, because man, the network is like wildfire. It gets out there. Even though I'm not telling people we're getting bought and sold, or bought, I should say, people learn about it. And so other companies that expressed interest in the past were coming out of the woodwork, basically, you know, writing letters and offers to also buy. Again, it came back to, okay, well, that might have been another, you know, another seven figures from that company who wants to buy us. But what's in the best interest of what we're trying to accomplish here? Are the employees going to be happy? Is the software going to continue? Are the users who use our software, are the customers going to be taken care of? You know, what are the terms of the sale as well? I won't say what the amount was, but, you know, you get an amount sometimes and you think, well, I'll never have to work again. Well, not working again and retiring at age 45 is not what life is about. There are way too many things I have left to contribute to society and an obligation to do so. I have to use my God-given skills and talents and abilities to be able to continue to contribute. That's just the way I'm wired. And so, you know, after I sold, there was a period of non-compete. That's stopped now. That's over with. So once you sell, you can't now go start another software company and begin competing against, you know, the former company you just sold. That's not a thing. So I got into some real estate because, you know, with the proceeds, we did some investing and we were investing in some real estate. And I find it fascinating how they were picking the investments we were making because I was part of an investment group. Here again is sort of a note to all of your analysts out there. Your skill set is transferable literally everywhere. Literally everywhere. I, in real estate, was able to use the same techniques that I had employed as a crime analyst in real estate. I was analyzing MLS data. I was analyzing, you know, all the data that's available. I was analyzing how we were choosing where and when to place our next storage facility as an investment. All of this spatial, temporal, statistical, behavioral analysis can be incorporated and applied toward almost virtually any discipline. So don't think as an analyst that you're limited to, okay, well, I got to go get another crime analysis job. There is a vast world of opportunity out there. Real estate would be one of them. But nevertheless, I got into real estate, and that, and again, is where I noticed some deficiencies in how real estate was operating and thought I could have some impact there. And so, was about to go write a piece of software, and in doing what businesses do, which is do due diligence and do their market research, I realized there was already a company performing that type of analysis. And so I basically started using their software and didn't try and reinvent the wheel. But it was while doing real estate that I really came to the appreciation of how important networking is and how important the relationship between the customer and the business is. Because as everybody on your podcast probably knows who owns a house or has dealt with any sort of real estate agent, you really have to have a strong relationship with that individual. They need to know what it is you want, what it is you don't want, and what your needs are. And that comes with a lot of probing questions and getting to know that individual and finding the right house for that individual. So there was a period where I was realizing that to do the type of real estate that I wanted to be able to do and interact with people the way I wanted to be able to interact with them, I needed a better tool because my contacts were bloated, they were duplicated, they were horrible, and there really wasn't anything out there to keep track of all my friends and family and my business associates and all of that. So that's when I started this other company to basically write an application that would help me be a better me. Because that's what I've always tried to do throughout my entire law enforcement career was treat the customer right. And I think that's what a lot of our success came from was the not only the analysts, but the police departments themselves knowing that they could literally call Sean's cell phone. I want to talk to Sean, put Sean on the phone. And they would get me and I would spend time with them and I would try and solve problems and I would connect and I would try and figure out the problems with them. And I would try and even help them with analysis. It was all about helping that analyst and helping that department because I knew that was the right thing to do. And it wasn't because I knew that it was a good ROI, return on investment. I knew it because I wanted them to do what was in my soul, which is catch bad guys and further justice. So I wanted them to be successful. And so that success just, you know, returned back. You give, you get. And so I wanted to be able to have this in my own sort of life now, where I'm continuing to try and reach out to people and do right by people and remember important things about people and recognize and acknowledge people for what they're doing and help them achieve their goals. And so that's why I, again, like I said, I got interested and started yet this other company. So retirement's not all it's made up to be, I guess is my point. I'll be working till the day I die. Money's not everything. What a long answer to your question of what was the amount that I sold the company for.
And you're referring to ZooWho.
I'm not going
to
tell you.
The ZooWho app is what you're talking about in terms of building and nurturing relationships.
Yeah, I didn't really appreciate as deeply as I do today. And a lot of it came from church, to be honest with you. I became really active in our church at the exact same time I was selling the company. And it was a busy time for me, let me tell you. But nevertheless, in my church, I belong to the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints. One of the things we do is we minister to people. So I had families that I was responsible for just to make sure that their needs are met. And do they need anything? Like, for example, right now with Corona, you asked early on, the first question was, how you doing? I'm doing just great. And the reason is I've got families who are looking out for me and they've called me and they've emailed me and they've stopped by and they've brought by, you know, supplies and all of a sudden there's toilet paper on the doorstep. I mean, and we do that for them. And it's just, we're looking out for our neighbors. We're loving each other, right? And so when doing ministering, it's important, obviously, to really get to know and love your families that you're responsible for. And in doing so, people who are on your podcast who know me well know that I do not have the best memory. And they're probably laughing right now. My memory is not actually great. Thankfully, I surrounded myself with people who have great memories because they remember everything for me and remind me. But when I would go to minister and or I would go to do real estate and or I would go to do whatever I was doing, I would meet people and they would tell me their name and they would tell me all about themselves. And I would genuinely be interested and want to know it. But for whatever reason, the way my brain is wired is in one ear and it's out the other. And I hated that because I wanted to be able to remember and I wanted to be able to recognize and acknowledge them for their, you know, for them. And so I decided, you know what, this is it. I'm done with this. And I started taking notes. Anytime I would meet somebody, the moment I was out of their sight, I would jump into my notes and I would just enter notes about them and what our conversation was. Things that I found interesting, like they were left-handed or they like hockey or they played softball in college or their favorite band is Rush or whatever that factoid was. Sometimes those get lost pretty quickly with us. But I wanted to remember those because I also want to keep them in my mind because I want to love and care for people. So one of the things I want to be able to do is regularly be reminded of things. So for example, I mentioned left-handed because I'm left-handed and lefties are pretty screwed up individuals, but we do like to be acknowledged for our screwed upness. So what I do is for my left-handed buddies, I send an email on National Left-Handed Day saying, hey, just, you know, celebrating your quirkiness, fellow lefty, hope you're having a good day. You know, go open a can with a can opener. Good luck. You know, so I'll do stuff like that just to acknowledge but remember that thing that's important to them. Mm-hmm. And so, but again, it's getting back to everything's about data and everything's about analysis and the kind of data that is being gathered through this application. I'd like to be able to analyze that so I can find trends in it and be able to better serve those who are in my network. And so I found that through doing business as well as doing ministering, that I wanted to be able to have one application where everything went. I typically go to LinkedIn for business. I'll go to Facebook for friends, although Facebook nowadays, you know. But for ministering, I go to my notes, but I wanted it all in the same spot. I want to know your business background, but also your personal interest, because those are all going to go in one spot. And so that's what we're trying to build with the company ZooWho. We're about to release version 2, and it's going to be called Circles, because we've found that people kind of group their individuals based on circles, like my inner circle, my family circle, my hockey circle, my crime analysis peep circle, so on and so forth. So you can deal with them like that. But yeah, so that's my new venture, and it's going good. Been able to hire some people, which is also good. We got about 10,000 users in about 115 countries, so it's getting out there. But you know, there's a saying in software development that if you don't hate your first version, you've waited too long to release. Uh-huh. And I can tell you, we didn't wait too long to release. I'm not a big fan of our version 1. So I'm eager to get this next version out, which is imminent.
Very good. I am sure it'll be great, just like everything else that you've done.
Thank you.
So the last segment is words to the world. So I leave it up to the guests to give me the last word. So you can promote any idea, you can talk about whatever you want. I'll leave it up to you to give our audience your words to the world.
I don't want to plug anything. I don't want to give any advice. I just want to give my utmost thanks and gratitude to all the people in public safety, in law enforcement, in the defense world, for all the amazing work that they do. It's truly God's work. I could not be a cop today. I was a cop 20 years ago. I couldn't do it today. I don't know how police officers do it. It's the hardest job I've ever had, and I can't even imagine what it's like now. God bless you. God bless the crime analysts out there that are on this podcast that are maybe using our software or not. It doesn't matter. Whatever you're using, you've got a hard job, and I know it, and I empathize, and bless you for doing it. It's oftentimes a thankless job, but I appreciate all you do and your contributions to keeping us all safe. So thank you.
Very good. Well, I always tell our guests, you've given me just enough to talk bad about you later. So I appreciate your words, and I appreciate your time, Sean. So thank you again, and be safe.
Thank you, you too. Take care.
Thank you for joining us today on Analyst Talk with Jason Alder. We hope you not only enjoyed the show, but also learned something new. For more information on our guests and information relating to today's topic, please visit our website at leapodcast.com. Special thanks to The Rough and Tumble for our theme song. For more of their music, you can visit their website at theroughandtumble.com. Also thanks to Kyle McMullen for our show logo. For more of his design, please visit his website at moderntype.com. The show is hosted, recorded, and edited by Jason Elder, and written by me, Mindy. You can contact us both via the LEA Podcast website. Please join us again next time as we interview another expert in this great field.